Hey everybody, welcome back. This is the first video in a series on radiation units and measurements. There's actually several ways that we might need to measure radiation. We could measure the amount of radiation in the primary beam. We could also measure the amount of secondary radiation escaping the X-ray tube as leakage radiation. We could also measure the amount of radiation absorbed in the patient. And of course, we could measure the amount of radiation absorbed in you, the healthcare provider. Each of these measurements can be quantified in different ways. Some of the most common measurements include exposure, air kerma, absorbed dose, equivalent dose, and effective dose. These measurements are closely related to each other, but they are not the same. You could think of it like this. There are several ways that you could measure this basket of fruit. You could measure the mass in kilograms, but you could also measure the height in meters. You could measure the volume in liters. You could even measure the total energy of this fruit basket in calories. All of these measurements are definitely related to each other in some ways, but they're also obviously very different in other ways. The units and quantities used to measure radiation are just like this. Radiation measurements fall into two main categories: radiation in air and radiation in tissue. Radiation in air is a measure of the radiation intensity. These measurements include exposure and air kerma. Radiation in tissue is a measure of dose. These measurements include absorbed dose, equivalent dose, and effective dose. All of these measurements are different but related. Here's an example. If we wanted to, we could measure each of these values during a single X-ray exposure. The intensity of the X-ray beam is usually measured as the exposure or the air kerma. These values tell us how much radiation is coming out of the X-ray tube and is directed at the patient. We could also use the air kerma and exposure to measure the leakage radiation escaping the tube housing. The dose to the patient or the healthcare worker or anyone is first measured as the absorbed dose, but then the absorbed dose can be calculated and converted into the equivalent dose, and then equivalent dose can be converted into effective dose. So why do we need these two categories and five different ways to measure radiation? Well, first off, there's actually more than five ways to quantify radiation. But the main reason is that each of these measurements is used in different ways and tell us something different about the radiation exposure. For example, absorbed dose tells us how much radiation energy was absorbed in the patient or in the healthcare worker. We can use this number to evaluate the risk of short-term radiation effects like skin erythema or hair loss, but absorbed dose tells us very little about the risk of long-term effects like cancer. And that's why we need another dose measurement, which is the effective dose. Effective dose is used to evaluate the long-term effects like cancer, but it is not used to calculate the total absorbed energy in the patient, and we cannot use effective dose to predict short-term effects like skin erythema or epilation. So even though these dose measurements might be used in different ways, we also understand that they're related in some ways. Fortunately, most of these measurements are influenced in the same way by the same variables. For example, if we increase the MA and nothing else has changed, this is going to increase the beam intensity, which will then increase the exposure as well as the air kerma, and that's going to result in an increase in the absorbed dose, the equivalent dose, and the effective dose. The same thing is true for KVP. If we increase the KVP and don't change anything else, this is also going to increase the beam intensity. This will result in a measurable increase in the exposure and the air kerma. And if that increases, it's also going to increase the absorbed dose to the person, as well as increase their equivalent dose and their effective dose. We could also change the distance, and the result is different. If we increase the distance between the person and the X-ray source, this is going to result in a decrease in the intensity of the X-ray beam, which, according to the inverse square law, will then result in a measurable decrease in the exposure and air kerma. And if those things are decreasing, the absorbed dose, the equivalent dose, and the effective dose also all decrease. It's good to know that all of these measurements are related to each other. Here's a practice question to make sure you understand these concepts. Which of these radiation measurements are commonly used to evaluate the intensity of the X-ray beam in air? Select multiple answers. Since we're looking to measure the intensity of the X-ray beam in air, this question has only two correct answers. If we're measuring the X-ray beam in air, we can measure the air kerma, or we could measure the exposure.
If you enjoyed this video, I encourage you to visit cloverlearning.com and explore our robust selection of video-based courses, certification exam prep question banks, and continuing education resources. Lastly, please remember to hit the like button, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you can stay up to date on our latest videos.